Well, thank you very much, all of you, for joining us in what's supposed to be, or at least hopefully will be, a very exciting session. It's a Wednesday afternoon. That's a lot more people than I thought there will be. It's a weekday afternoon. I know why I'm here. I would pass up no chance to hang with two wonderful ladies, extremely prolific producers in the entertainment industry, starting with Bollywood, of course. Emmay Entertainment, both of you, I guess, started about a decade ago, decade plus, I think 11 years ago. And in that time, if IMDb serves me right, you guys have 24 productions to your credit already. I think Madhu, Bhojwani, Monisha, Advani, you deserve a bigger round of applause than you've got so far.
Thank you. Thanks
so much, Mayank. Thanks, guys.
Now, obviously, we're going to discuss diversity, inclusivity. And in your context, I can see two areas which will be very, very relevant. One is the obvious one, which is the fact that both of you are women in what has traditionally been seen as a very male-dominated industry, that is entertainment in general. And we'll touch upon that at some point for sure. But I think the more important one in my mind is the fact that both of you also happen to be not from this industry, which has largely been dominated by a few film families over years. Of course, a lot changed with corporatization. There were studios that came up. From those studios, many people stepped out, started their own companies as well. But you guys literally came from somewhere else and started out. Monisha, Madhu, I'm going to start with first asking you, what were the industries and businesses that you were part of before you got into entertainment? I hear you were part of 4 to 5 businesses, Monisha.
Mayank, you're very kind. In a sense, I don't think we stopped being part of different businesses. Madhu and I continue to support young entrepreneurs. This is a fantastic forum that's in fact recognized that earlier. I'm really delighted, firstly, to be here, and thanks for asking us what we've done before this. We were in the human resources business. We ran a recruitment company which was founded way back in 1996, which grew to become one of the largest in India, was acquired by Randstad. I was managing director for Randstad India, their first managing director. Actually, I think one of their first female managing directors too, way back. And Madhu headed the executive search business. So we came literally from no background to the movie business other than being the ones who used to say that, yeah, Friday hai, jaake picture dekhte
hai. Right.
Including the fact that, I have a brother, I mean, we share parents, right? Nikhil and I. And he was in the movie business always. Hmm. And I had never watched his movie as a privilege earlier before it would be released, not one of those trial show experiences which now we host as producers. I used to literally go 2 weeks later, go stand in the line, get
a ticket. Why 2 weeks later though?
So very often I was working, I was traveling, and he would always call, it invariably was he releasing a film. And
so you saw Kal Ho Na Ho 2 weeks after it released? Really?
Literally. Wow. 2 weeks later, and the only film I saw probably in a trial show was Chandni Chowk to China, and then when I...
Maybe that's the one you shouldn't have seen.
No, so you have no idea. And I come out of Madhu and I, it's a cold day, cold night in London, and we come out shivering and both of us are looking, what was that? And Nikhil calls up and he says, what do you think? I said, well, your poster promised one thing, the movie was something else. He said, who do you think you are? And I won't name the critic, he called me. He said, you think you're this person? And I said, who's this person? I mean, okay, I can say Komal Natha. He said, you think you're Komal Natha? And I said, who's she? Of course, Komal Natha's a name. I had no clue. And that's how far removed we were from the business. And little did I know, literally 2 years from then, we were sitting with him, Madhu and I, and he conned us to start this business. He told us he'll take us to lunch, and he told us that this is a great business to be in. They're always going to... producers get to travel to exotic places. Look at where I've shot in New York, in London. And so Madhu and I thought, well, okay, this seems to be, a nice progression. We're retiring from the recruitment business. We've sold the company now. Golden handcuffs have come off. Why not? And, the first place we shot in, it was the underbelly of Ahmedabad. The next place we shot in, we went to shoot airlift, UAE, you think Dubai. We went to Ras Al Khaimah, which is literally, one of the most simple, rudimentary parts of the UAE. So it wasn't any glitz, no glamour. And even now, I mean, look at the shows we've done. When you look at Mumbai Diaries, Empire looks glamorous, looks grand.
Right.
But I mean, putting such shows together takes us into a lot of grit.
Uzbekistan was put up in Mud Island.
City? Oh, Mud Island, okay. But it looked really like the sets.
Well,
that
you know, we our intentions were to shoot in Uzbekistan, but unfortunately...
Fair enough. But Madhu, in your case, I mean, I can see somewhere where Monisha comes from, in the sense her brother was in the movie business, had been also a producer, right, leading up for most of his films right after his first. Were you like drawn to this as a movie buff, or how did this happen?
Be honest, Madhu. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, be honest, obviously.
Absolutely. So, you know, when Nikhil approached us, it was a thought that was farthest from my mind. And to be honest, I was...
So what did you have in your mind once you've sold a company and had made billions, I'm assuming?
So, you know, when you...
You didn't correct me, you actually made billions. Did you?
Why?
How much did you make? I mean, this...
I think that's for another conversation. Okay. But, you know, to be honest, I think Monisha and myself have, started out very early in our careers, and we've been fortunate as friends to have worked together and built companies, etc. And when we sold our previous company, of course, we were coming off a very grueling couple of years. And so it was the farthest from my mind, right? And so when Nikhil approached us...
Well, what was in your mind at the time?
To be honest, we had golden handcuffs. And so I was traveling,
Okay, I'm so not a corporate person. What's a golden handcuff?
So essentially...
It sounds very cool, but is it really as cool as it sounds?
It's a paid holiday.
Huh?
It's a paid holiday.
Essentially,
okay.
You do
so
not...
So you basically can't join a rival firm...
That's right.
Because you have this
That's
particular
right.
clause in
That's
your contract.
Right. That's right.
So this is the money and go chill.
Absolutely.
For how long?
So it had been about 2 years since. And so when Nikhil approached us, the idea was he wanted to set up a banner. I think he was looking for like-minded producers who would constantly sort of have his back, and he would be able to sort of give his creativity more wings. And Monisha and myself had a pretty decent business career. So he turned to us and said that this is something that I'd like to do. And honestly, we had absolutely no idea of how this business is run. And I was extremely skeptical, because for me, it's always about, you know, the hard data, which is the numbers. Does it work? Does it not work? Balancing of books, etc. Operations, you know, very brass tacks. And so I was extremely skeptical, Monisha being, you know, the ever optimist of the two of us, said that I think perhaps it's very similar to what we did in the HR business, which was when we entered that business, it was very unregulated. And we saw the trajectory of that sector change as, you know, as it got corporatized. And the film industry back in 2011 was at a very interesting point. And, just to give you a sense, movies up until that point used to be shot on film.
Right.
And when we made D-Day, it was one of the early films that actually got
digital.
Done on digital.
Right.
So clearly that was an inflection point for the sector. And in this past, 11 years that we've been in the business, incrementally we've seen it get more and more regulated, which has been really an interesting time for us to have gotten associated with the business. And we started out as skeptics.
Were you movie buff before?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, both of us have grown up, including Nikhil, on a diet of Amitabh Bachchan films. And, when is there not an instance in your life where a Hindi song is not playing for that, for what you're
But it's
going
not considered
to.
A niche thing. It's not like just because you watch movies, you want to be, because everyone loves the movies.
But you know what I tell Nikhil today? I said, I blame you for the fact that you've just taken out the fun of watching movies for me, because every time now I get in front of a screen, I'm thinking to myself, when I see a big song sequence, how many dancers, how much did this cost, where did they shoot this? So you're just dissecting every frame
or why
of
didn't
what
we make
watch,
it
or why did we
why did
not
make,
make
it?
It
oh why did you not make it
yeah.
right
you know right you feel that I mean ever so often now, because there's such great content being churned
have out. You had instances where there were things that were offered to you? And I want you to be really, really candid today, because it's just the three of us and a few people here, where you said no to something, and then you looked at it on the screen, it's like, why did we not make it?
Badai ho.
Badai ho?
I'm telling you.
So that came
I
to you first?
It came, and the writer very sweetly sat in front of me, told me, this is a story, I think you'll get it. It's very progressive. I said, sure, tell me. And he said, a 60-year-old woman gets pregnant. And I looked at him, I said, Matt? And he narrated the whole thing to me. And I told him, I said, dude, you're a good storyteller. I can't figure this out. And I cut to 2 years later, I'm sitting at Inox, and you know, we had a film simultaneous to them release called Bazaar, which did reasonably well. Mm. But I mean, Bazaar was always in a 20-seater room, theater in the multiplex, and this was in the 200-seater. And I used to be sitting outside and listening to everybody go, yay, clapping, and I was like, So yeah, regret. And I tell that to a lot of writers who come, and when they tell me what they're doing, and I tell them, listen, I'm here to support you. That's great you're doing that. I'm very jealous that you're doing this as well. And I think it's just good to admit that, because it also makes people realize and feel valued. Mm. And a lot of technicians in this business, I feel, you know, I think it's such a skewed industry in a sense, because 20% of the headliners actually land up getting a lot of the attention. It's like the Mona Lisa, right? Everyone knows who the painting is. About 10% know it was done by a guy called, and when I say Leonardo, you'll be amazed how many people say DiCaprio. You know?
No, I won't be amazed. I totally get that.
Yeah.
But you know, coming back to where you're from and where you are, right? Now, when you move from an HR business practice, I'm assuming an HR consultancy firm, you come to a place which is also very HR-led in a real sense. It's a people's business. It's people and their craft and their talent that shows. Everything else can be rented. You hire everything else, right? What is it that you found that was very different in this industry from the ones that you'd worked in before?
Two things. Okay. One, I find that there's very little, and like you rightly said, Mayank, the industry largely attracts a lot of legacy, family, lifestyle-owned businesses. There's nothing wrong with that, because some of the largest corporations that run our country today are nation builders, because they started with that multi-generation approach. Mm. And the film industry is no different for a hundred-odd-year-old sector. It has a lot of these legacy companies which are there respectfully. The challenge is that it's all driven towards supporting their lifestyles, those family, multi-generational lifestyles.
Right.
And because of the nature of the business being gig economy, there is a very little propensity towards reinvesting back to grow the operational side of the business. Mm. And that's
But the picture chal gaya to Bentley mil gaya.
बिल्कुल आपने तो बेंटी बोल दिया मैं तो अभी आजकल बोलती हूँ लैम्बोर्गिनी भी आ जाती है उसके साथ एक बंगला भी आ जाता है पोर्चुगल में सो इट्स अ रियल स्ट्रेन ऑन द वे एंड व्हेन वी देन वी सिट एंड लमेंट दैट व्हाई इज इट दैट द थिएट्रिकल बिजनेस ऑफ दिस कंट्री इज आफ्टर ऑल दीज इयर्स इट्स एन इन्वेंट्री क्यूमुलेटिवली ऑफ 10,000 क्रोर्स 10,000 क्रोर्स इज द साइज ऑफ अ मिड कैप कंपनी ऑन द बीएससी एंड सो एंड दिस इज व्हाट वी कंसिडर टू बी द सॉफ्ट पावर the greatest generator of influencers in our society.
Right.
And that's the size it's stayed at. It's just grown, and most of that growth, 50% of that growth, has come largely in the last 4 years.
Mm.
So thanks to the advent of technology, platforms embracing the development of content, and that's somewhere the flaw. So that's the first challenge. I feel the investment to grow the sector has been, and I think the second learning for me, different from other corporations has been, or industries, has been patience. You know, in this, you even when you plant a seed as a child, and you know, we should do that experiment where you put a seed and you keep watering it over the cotton and it starts giving you the shoots. Mm. There's still a predictability in that. There's no predictability in the content business. You are always on the input side, which is the only part which is controllable. The output is a variable. You can make the best film with the best headliners ever, top actors, the top studio, and no audience will embrace it. Nobody will show up.
Right.
So for me, it takes a lot of patience to see that cycle through and come back to work. So yeah, I think these are the two big learnings for us.
I think for me in this business, you know, the successes, the adulation around it is very, it's a big high.
Mm.
And the failures, when you have the failure or you experience the failure, it's firstly so public, and the silence after that is deafening, and you have to drag yourself back to work, you know. And so I think that when I compare it to any other business or even our past businesses, you didn't have this kind of, you know, you're constantly, you're in an aquarium and you're the fish. You know, and so you're constantly getting on a weighing scale on a day-to-day basis, in a sense, because you work for an 18-month cycle to put together a project, and it's no different, right? Whether you make a film which has an A-list actor, or you make a film which has, you know, an also-ran. It's the same effort. You still go through a cycle of 12 to 18 months. And at the end of that, this is the outcome. So it can be very uplifting and at the same time can be very demotivating.
And so does that lead to some element of insecurity as well, a far more rivalry that you would see compared to other businesses? And the reason I'm saying that is because when you're talking about an 18-month cycle, for instance, in that 18 months, you've actually put together a company. And that company is that film.
Yep.
And they all come together and then they all dismantle and go to various other companies, right? It's not like other businesses where they just keep making the same product. Every time this new company makes a new product, which is the film. One, do you think that leads to greater insecurity? People are too bothered about what others are doing? Because that's what's the general perception in any case. Second, and this is the part that I want you to delve on a little later and a little further as well, is it also perhaps one of the most insular places, given the families you spoke of, the Bentleys and their houses in Portugal? They actually don't know what's happening in the world outside of them when you compare it to other businesses which have greater linkages with others. First, tell me about the insecurity. Did you feel this was a little more insecure than you've dealt with before?
Most definitely. And, you know, there's a term for it, which is the crab mentality. And it's very much prevalent in this business. But I think the way that, you know, we insulate ourselves from it is, you know, to keep, to have a Monday-to-Monday approach, as Monisha puts it, which is that the way that, you know, you're able to keep yourself going is to know that you're coming back to work irrespective of the outcome of what you do. And fortunately for us, I think the fact that we don't come from this business or we don't have antecedents beyond the fact that we've been in this business for about a decade, once we proverbially cross the ceiling, we've crossed the ceiling.
Literally so, huh?
Yeah, pretty much so. And so it's very important for us to stay grounded and to keep in perspective that, you know, we come back Monday to Monday and we build this as a business and we keep reinvesting in what we're creating. That's the way that we approach it.
And to add to that, I think what we've done differently in these 11 years, Mayank, is we've added people back into the system. So today, when people turn around and say, how the hell is this company able to do, you know, 10 projects a year? We're doing 4 films, 6 shows, and they're not small, each one. I mean, the shows are massive. How is this company able to put out a Rocket Boys, a Mumbai Diaries, an Empire, Kaun Banegi Shikharvati, all at the same time? And it's really because we sat back about 5 years ago, 6 years ago, and said, listen, we've got to do this differently. We've got to build the infrastructure because there is this thing out there that's coming. We're talking about being here at the streaming summit, right? I'm saying this immodestly, we called it out way back in 2011 when we started this company, and it took a little convincing, Nikhil, but, you know, I said, listen, this is what's coming. I've sat in rooms with Siddharth Roy Kapoor, with Vijay Singh, and I've said, well, guys, what about digital? Are you guys thinking about that? And they've just looked, yeah, how soon can you make a film that's like Kal Ho Na Ho? And I'm like, no, let's talk about digital. And now tables are turned because this is what's the future. We anticipated that, man. And which is why we built operationally in the company. So today when somebody turns and comes to us with an idea, we're able to back it. The second thing we did is if you look at our projects, buying the ones Nikhil headlines, most of them are new directors, new technicians, first timers, whether it's in the field of art, whether it's in the field of styling, whether it's in the field of it's a cinematography, every aspect of the business, we've always tried and taken bets on new talent. And today, even when then it was a budgetary constraint, today we've got, thankfully, some premium attached to us, so the budgets are more generous. We will still back new talent. Not because there's more margin to be had, but the idea is that if we don't start building the infrastructure for this business, we're going to stay at 10,000 crores turnover for theatricals. But then we talk about why is that dying? We've not built that demand. We've not catered to it. So I think that's the kind of perspective with which we come. Also, vanity is left at the ceiling. Most people don't see, they don't even know who we are.
So you guys don't hang around in these cool parties that you were promised by Nikhil when you came on board?
Firstly, he doesn't go to any of them himself.
He's a bit of a hermit, yeah?
Completely. Workaholic. Which is great. He has a great life. He enjoys what he does, but he does it with his family. And likewise, we also have that distinction. I think everybody in this room will appreciate the fact work-life balance is applicable everywhere. In this business, most of the times, I find that those are blurred lines. And that's where the insecurity comes in, because you're constantly looking at how the staff at home are perceiving you. You're concerned about what the person at the nukkad is going to think of you. Whereas we've been trained fairly with middle class values that, listen, boss, this is your work. You go to work, you come back home, you make your bed and you sleep in it. It's as simple as that.
Speaking of parties, I think none of us can keep our eyes open beyond 10:30. And we are very early risers, which is very alien to this business. We begin our days, and I mean, Nikhil, Monisha, myself, all three of us work with this discipline. By 6 o'clock, our chats go live internally.
Internally, clearly, right? Because if you were to like schedule a meeting with somebody at 6 o'clock in the morning, you find maybe Akshay Kumar in his gym, which is also a lot of urban legend. Huh? It's not like he's serious morning person. It's just things that people say to also build a legend about themselves. I'm sure he is, but it's not like he does nothing else but wakes up at 4
Nikhil
o'clock.
Nikhil sat in narrations at 5:30 a.m. with him. So it's true because we've worked with him.
Right. He's tested you and me, whether we were standing outside waiting to take him in the car to the set when we were shooting Airlift, and at 6 in the morning that too, and we were there.
That's what makes you different from all the traditional producers that we've had over a period of time, right? Including ones who probably set up their own companies, starting out from corporations and studios, as it were. There's a lot of chit-chat, there's a lot of gossip, who's doing what, who's doing whom, something that you may not see so much of in say, cement industry. I'm pretty sure they're not interested in who's sleeping with whom, but that's the conversation you still make.
But that's the culture we come from, right? And so when we did start this business, even the approach to the business was to see how can we build predictability into the business. Mm-hmm. How do you look at the various metrics? How do you look at spreadsheets, not only for film budgets, but for your annual budget, which is an alien concept because, like you rightly said, it's such a gig economy. It just goes from project to project to project. Nobody is looking at building the whole, the company per se. And that's what we started with.
I think there are a few companies that are doing it very well now. Whether you look at what Sameer is doing with Applause, whether you look at what Apurva and Karan are trying to do with Dharma, what you see happening with, I think Clean Slate is also getting in there. You know, Dino's trying to professionalize it. So I think a lot of the independent guys are now getting their act together and realizing that you have to scale, you have to invest, and build that infrastructure.
Yeah, I mean, but the people that you mentioned are all typically Versova guys, including Karan Johar. I mean, how the mighty fallen. He was a South Bombay guy, but clearly is now a Bandra.
He's not going to be happy about you calling him a Versova guy.
Huh?
I said, he's not going to be happy about you calling him a Versova.
Well, but that is the truth, isn't it? That's where...
Well, we went to the same school.
Right.
Karan, Monisha, Nikhil, myself, Apurva, we were all in the same school. So yeah, you're right, South Bombay, but you'll never take the South Bombay out of him.
So what happens when a South Bombay person enters a situation like Bollywood? There are two possibilities. One is that you could be snooty about it, that this is a world so different from you and this is not something that, you know, you've always looked down upon in a certain way, or you become extremely starstruck. Tell me about the first time you met like a movie star. Did something happen to you? Go for
Shekhar
it.
Kumar.
First star I met was Akshay Kumar.
Okay, maybe somebody else. We've heard the Akshay Kumar bit.
Amitabh Bachchan.
Amitabh Bachchan, usually that's the story.
Yeah, yeah. We met Amitabh Bachchan when we were very early, I think, after we set up the company. And we were trying to do a film together. And you cannot not be awestruck by him. Right? I mean, Amitabh Bachchan is Amitabh Bachchan. And then there's the rest of the industry.
So, but does it go down over a period of time? Or do you remain... firstly, tell me, were you snoots or were you...
Oh, no, not at all. We were absolute fangirls when it came to him, right?
Across, but in Bollywood in general.
Well, you know, the two instances you talked about, I think it's neither. Because, like I said, nor do we take a snooty approach, nor are we, you know, enamored by it. We just take a very middle path approach, which is, this is our work, and that's how we come at it. I don't think it's either. And
I think honestly, actors feel a little. Initially, they feel a little intimidated. They won't admit it, but when they meet with, especially the two of us, they don't know how to peg us.
Because you guys don't act starstruck, you don't give a shit kind of situation?
I don't think it's even a question of starstruck. First, they start by saying we speak English too well. I've had a couple of them turn around and actually, you know what, English is very good.
What does that mean?
I've had a couple of them actually call out, but Madhu had somebody call up and ask her, kisi ne mujhe bola ki wo apne kutte ko vet ke paas le gaya hai, uska matlab kya hai? So, when you get, you know, the point.
But to be fair, it's the Hindi film industry. So,
I get it.
Yeah.
I totally get it. Yeah. So, we then switched to speaking Hindi, and then our Hindi is that school Hindi, which is very, very true.
It's South Bombay Hindi, basically.
No, we are not that caricatured driver kya karta hai and all of that. No, we will speak proper Hindi.
Right.
But I think what's really funny is the fact that, and I can see it, I've sat with, I remember very early on, I don't know if you remember, Madhu, we met with Ranbir Kapoor.
Yeah.
I'm talking way, 11 years ago. And he listened to us and he kept, you know, he bites his nails. And I can't forget that vision on him. He's biting his nails, listening. And Nikhil saying a bunch of things. He's looking at the two of us. And we finished. Chola, South Bombay, both of you, right? And the two of us. And I looked at him, I said, how is it relevant?
Huh.
And he goes, which school? I said, how is that relevant? I can tell. I can tell. And it was like a triumphant moment for him that he could call it out. And whereas for us, we don't go into the situation thinking either. You've got to understand, like, we ran a company before which had 1,800 employees all over the country, 42,000 indirect employees. And I can assure you, there was probably about 10 of them who came from South Bombay. So you don't get to that number by being, segretarian or turning around and bringing your prejudices into it. We have to keep a very open. And we are that way. We're built to support talent. I think that's one of our intrinsic qualities today.
Did you find this place also a little more male-dominated than other businesses you've been part of? As women, do you really stand out in that sense?
That's definitely the case. I think the entertainment industry has predominantly been male-dominated, especially on the business side. Forget about the narratives.
Right.
On the business side, I mean, today if you look at, I was just reading about the fact that, you know, there was this film companion report, you know, the Ovomania. I mean, I think you're looking at technicians or HODs, you know, on the filmmaking side, not exceeding a number of 15% of the...
Which is still 15% higher than it was, about 30
right,
years ago.
Perhaps,
right.
And when you compare that with the South industry, we fare very well. In Bollywood,
yeah.
But it's still a very dismal number. So yes, you're absolutely right, extremely male-dominated. But what we've seen happening, Mayank, you know, over the past, I'd say, 4 years, is there is a definite shift, and you can even see it in the narrative. And I think what OTT has done today is it has democratized the kind of content that we are seeing. You're beginning to see the female gaze on screen a lot more. There are women directors, there are some departments where the number is dismal, like cinematographers. 2% of the number of cinematographers that we have are women, 2%.
Right. Right.
It's as low as that. So you're absolutely right, extremely male dominated, but I think it's changing. Of course, we still have a long way to go.
And of course, it helps to have women leaders, because that's where the change is going to come from.
Yeah, absolutely.
From your perspective. But there's one thing that you constantly mentioned, Madhu, is last 4 years. And the last 4 years, obviously, talking about the OTT revolution that you guys have been really very much been part of. But the flip side to that is, and a lot of people have issue with it, they're talking about how Bollywood has been completely decimated as a result. I mean, you take, I saw you at the Amazon Prime Video slate launch, and practically that was basically Bollywood there. As home entertainment is being serviced by Bollywood industry, which should be doing theatrical releases, where you see South completely dominating, based on, of course, only 3 films so far, but those numbers are huge. Do you think it's an unfair criticism that essentially a lot of Bollywood producers became vendors for OTT platforms, leaving aside a really big industry, a theatrical right across the country that was still 60% revenue for a movie?
Well, I think that you know, what has played a very important role in this transition has been the pandemic. We know that during the 24 months that, and we're still not out of it, right? I mean, but during those 24 months, a lot of producers saw the transition to OTT as an alternate to survival. I mean, if you didn't get on that bandwagon, either you had the ability or the staying power to tide over that period of 2 years, or then you found a way to make it work during that period. And OTT is what has actually kept a lot of producers going. Having said that, I don't believe that it's the demise of the theatrical experience. I think we will probably see it come. You've already seen it with the South films, right?
Yeah.
I just think that we have to buck up. The kind of stories that we bring to the theaters have to be, either spectacle films, or they have to be compelling enough for you to come to the theaters, because it's not like people are not going to the theater.
No, they clearly are. They're just not going to watch Bollywood movies, apparently, because series of flops and three amazing hits from the South, which were completely unheard of in terms of the lopsidedness of revenues, right?
So a couple of things there. I think that if you look at, make the reference of 10,000 crores, Mayank, that breaks down to actually roughly about a 10 million footfall, unique footfall that is committed to watching cinema in our country, going to the theaters.
Correct.
Out of a 1.3 billion population,
that's just 1 crore people going to watch movies.
It's just 10 million. Right. And that 1 crore is spending 1,000 rupees per annum, which means they're buying on an average, take 250 rupees for tickets a year. Now, what are we talking about? Is it because of the fact that we're not converting more? And when it's all about the reach. We've not had enough screens. When we talk about the streaming revolution in these 4 years, you've also seen a growth of cinema screens. You've had single screens turning into multiplex, so going into 2, 3, 4, 5 screen formats. And all of that has come in at the same time. The pandemic is a watershed moment that has had a transformation of societal choices. So we put that to the side. If you look at what we've done as an industry right now, we've been really catering to a very sliver of an audience. It's just so stereophonic in the years of the people who actually consume that content or make that content. So we think that it's the world. We also recognize, we fail to acknowledge the fact that a lot of the influencers that come out of this industry are actually serving the larger 78,000 crore advertising industry that sits.
Right.
And now that is even exponentially burst further with the way paid partnerships work, or you know, endorsements, online endorsements,
even social media, right?
It's massive, right? So when you look at actually what we are doing over here, is we are like a ecosystem which is producing for a lot of the other thought leadership, in whether it's in a consumer environment, whether it's in an ideological environment, but that's what we are actually doing as this little cottage industry, and we've got to transform that. Two, I think that when you look at theatrical, when the South content that's coming across, it's catered to a family audience. What's happened predominantly with Hindi content, I don't think it's just about what the OTT provides, the OTT industry provides. We have intentionally segmented our audience. And what we've done in that manner is we were quite happy turning around saying, hey, you know what, this is going to be a Saturday film, not a Friday film. Which means that I'm okay if the film comes and then people, word of mouth, will come in on a Saturday. I'm happy for this to be a Monday to Friday film. We actually started classifying things in that manner, but we were also responding to audience consumption patterns. So I think it's a chicken and egg situation as to what is going where. I just know one thing, there's more content being made today than there was yesterday. And there's more content that's going to be made tomorrow. You may see a lot of headlines grabbed there saying that, oh, you know, this platform's not performing, theaters are not performing, but people are consuming more and more content. And more organized that sector becomes, the better it's going to be, the more stories are going to be told, and that's where that whole term democratization will come, because you'll have a larger audience, larger population serving a larger audience.
Well, you know, we started this conversation somewhat with how, as against other industries that you've been part of, this is the most public of them all, right? everything that you put out, everyone has something or the other to say, sometimes good, sometimes not so good. You are also three completely different individuals yourselves. You, both of you, and of course Nikhil Advani, who was a filmmaker and has been a filmmaker all through, but even before you guys entered, he was always there. I want to know, like, do you guys have conversations about what you've put out, and sometimes you like something and the other two don't? How does that work?
All the time.
Be candid. Tell me Absolutely. Something that you loved and the others did not.
Well, there's a lot of stuff that we constantly, you know, chide each other about for the choices that, you know, we've made. But when we do make anything, but when we do make anything, you know, we commit ourselves to it, and then of course, notwithstanding the performance, we still hold on to our opinions. So, for instance, Monisha is very aligned to mass cinema, and you know, so Satyamev Jayate, Marjava, those were attributed choices, you know, to Monisha. And of course, and the successes, and you know, you applaud her for those choices.
Was a huge success.
Then there is, you know, stuff like Mumbai Diaries or the gritty stuff that Nikhil, you know, has transitioned to making, which again, sometimes we get on board with, sometimes we don't get on board with. But I personally, you know, of course, I think Rocket Boys we were unanimous with. But there
hang on. I have to confess here. You hear it here first. When Rocket Boys was being put together, I was really skeptical, and I've had private conversations with Nikhil. And I said, Nikhil, really, do you think that we can get this audience to hook into the story of two notable scientists, nation builders, but I mean, where's the reference to context? And he was so determined. He says, no, watch it. See what's good. Right till the day it came out. It was beautiful when we were watching as it was turning out. And of course, there was a lot of heartbleed in seeing the kind of production we were having to manage. But at the end of it, I can tell you that the love that show has received and the interest, and it's just surpassed any of my skepticism.
Nikhil and I were sold from the word go. We just loved the premise, and of course, the way it turned out was, it just surpassed our own expectations.
Yeah, I mean, right? There's going to be awards, the Exchange for Media Awards for OTT platforms, but of course, Rocket Boy is not really part of it because it's 2022, but I can say with fair amount of stuff watched over the year so far, it is absolutely the best show that came out on OTT platform in 2022.
Thank you.
I mean, congratulations. I'm not just saying this because you guys are here, but it literally was something we hadn't seen before. How much does the platform where it appears on matter to you guys? Because a lot of people would not have seen it purely because there aren't that many subscribers to a Sony Live as compared to, say, a Netflix, or even for that matter, I mean, of course, Hotstar and the others are bigger numbers, much bigger numbers.
So I think, of course, the platform matters. But I will say this, that, you know, Sony pulled out all the stops on marketing the show, and they did a fantastic job. And not only backing it, but, you know, one is to, of course, you know, put the money down and say that we are going to produce the show. But to, in the last mile, do everything that it takes to put it out there, because I think that is the most important.
So what's the model you work on? Is it that the platform commissions you, or do you make it and thereafter go shopping for the best bidder? Is that how it works? Which of the two do you?
So far we've followed the former, which is that we've worked with platforms on a commission model.
Okay.
And we're working towards transitioning into the latter. I mean, that is, we ourselves are seeing a growth trajectory for Emmay
Entertainment. When we say commission, I think, Mike, what we land up doing is a lot of the stories are generated by us, and we then take it out and speak to, and we do a lot of precision targeting, which is, we identify that this is the kind of content that there is an appetite in this platform or these platforms. Let's just take it to them and see what they would have to, how they would have to react to it. I mean, and I can tell you, besides, I mean, Mumbai Diaries, for instance, it was literally one meeting with Aparna and their then head of the company. And we, you know, we were sitting there and she said to Nikhil, she said, what do you really want to make? And he says, you know what, I've always wanted to make a medical drama. I'm a huge fan of Grey's Anatomy. I want to make something which is rooted, but I want to make it in Bombay. And I want to always give an ode to my city. And she turned around and she says, that's the line. Okay, send me an email. And let's get your people to talk to our people, and let's develop this. And it has organically grown into where we're shooting the second season right now. The third season is being written. It's a very exciting show. And there's a lot of love that's come for it. So again, it's literally where we land. It wasn't an accidental thing. It was really, he knew Amazon's the place where this is going to get the platform and the love. And I mean, that's how we've built up our repertoire.
So in that sense, if you were, we were to compare OTT platforms to the typical Bollywood model, which would be a star-driven system, where you actually go to a movie star and you pitch that particular script and the movie star says yes, which means that film will get made. Do you think OTT is the new star in this particular format? It's the platform that says yes and everything else falls into place?
For the money, sure. But I mean, I don't think that the movie stars have that. There's a guy called Bhushan Kumar and there are a bunch of other studios who are similar to him, who actually, like I said, everyone goes looking for Mona Lisa. Mm. There's Da Vinci and then there's the rich family that commissioned the portrait. Right. Nobody really looks at those headlines, but those are really where you're right. That's where the chips fall. And I think, and with a little immodesty, and I hope I don't sound arrogant, but it, what the OTT platform has done is it's given creators, makers, producers, the opportunity to be the stars.
Mm.
And that credibility has transferred into us being able to actually get actors and break through the star system and put them out in ways that nobody expected them to, because of the fact that we can invest so much in character-driven content, mm. right? And it's fascinating how a lot of these actors, people, when they see them on hoardings or when they see them in the show, and they go, oh gosh, do you know he's the guy who was, you know, with Ranveer Singh in that movie and he was singing a song to him and guess what, he's Homi Baba now.
Hmm.
And it's so fantastic when people turn around and say, Dino Moria, arre wo to villain hai. And he, I don't think in Dino's wildest dreams he would have ever thought that he's going to be part of such conversations or he's going to be on 5,000 hoardings around the country, right? And that's something that we feel really proud of, that we've been able to, and not just MAA, when you look at all the producers on OTT, we've been empowered to actually build our content in that manner and make the story, make the production, the real star.
Couldn't have put it better. These are two women empowering a lot of talent in the city through OTT platforms, of course, at this point. But I really hope this translates to theatrical releases too. Ladies and gentlemen, Madhu Bhojwani, Monisha Advani.
Thanks, guys. Thank you.